a certain man. And for the poor, you may be sure that he'll do all he can. Who is this one? Whose favorite son? Just by his action has the traction magnets on the run. Who likes to smoke? Enjoys a joke? And wouldn't get a bit upset if he were really broke. With wealth and fame, he's still the same. I'll bet you five you're not alive if you don't know his name.
This is a story about a wealthy man who is shown in the beginning of the movie dying in a desolated mansion. And though he was a gigantic figure in world history, he was a titan of the newspaper industry, there's still a great mystery to what he was really like. And this gets a reporter to go and meet the people involved in his life in order to try and sketch out a portrait of what really drove Charles Foster Kane, and what is a figure of Charles Foster Kane really about?
Well, here's my take on Citizen Kane. I think it's underrated. I think being the official greatest film ever made actually doesn't give it enough credit, because what's happened with this honor is a lot of people have been viewing Citizen Kane as a museum piece, as something for film school, as something to work through. And there's a lot of amazing film stuff we'll talk about here. But what doesn't get talked about enough is what an absolute joy and an absolute entertainment this film is. From start to finish, you could watch this over and over and see before your eyes the same excitement that Welles had at his train set that he got to play with, and now we get to enjoy.
It, I don't know how you call it, magic or miracle or what have you, but this is the case where he is doing so much that he, as a first-time filmmaker, had absolutely no idea if the tricks that he would do, the camera moves, the placement, the lighting, was going to work. And almost all of them worked triumphantly.
Right. And the first thing he did was surrounded himself with amazing pros. So he's brought the Mercury Theater cast in with him, as the supporting players, and he's got Herman Mankiewicz co-writing the script with him. There's been all kinds of controversy as to who can claim the most credit, but I don't think we're in a position to settle that here. But we can definitely give credit to Greg Tolan, who Welles had the vision to hire as a cinematographer, for creating a look of a film in a way that has never been seen before.
And has never been seen before in multiple ways. During the course of the film, you get these moments that could almost be done from a great horror film.
Mm-hmm.
You have these moments that could come from a great noir. You have moments of political satire. You have moments of relationship comedy and relationship drama.
Look at the very opening scene when you see a slow pan up from a fence in an abandoned mansion that was Xanadu, and a light in the window. And just the way this is shot from its first seconds applies what you said, because it is as ominous as anything in Dracula, Frankenstein. It is as mysterious as anything from any kind of thriller at the time. Then you go from that into this frantic newsreel that basically summarizes the entire film we're about to see in newsreel form and opens up this amazing structure of the film, because we're going to be following this News on the March reporter as he tries to find out the secret behind Kane's last words, Rosebud, and he interviews various people in his life. This structure is not only original and exciting to watch in and of itself, but it makes the film seem fresh every single time, because even after you've seen it, you don't really know what's coming next, because we're in the series of flashbacks within flashbacks. And that kind of structure would, again, work in a more modern popular film, Pulp Fiction.
When you look at the contrast between the very opening section and with the newsreel footage, both of which are giving a viewpoint of the same person, but in such different ways that, in fact, the movie from the very beginning almost gives you these endpoints of how are we to look at this person's life? And then when you finally get a chance to see the young Kane, both as a child and then as a young, bright, energetic character played by Orson Welles, you're left wondering. It gets them really compelling to wonder, how did a guy like that, how does a child like that get to be either of those two things that we saw in the beginning?
Right, and that really leads into what does Welles want us to think of Charles Foster Kane? Because here's a character that does some truly awful things during the course of the film, and yet there's still this roguish charm about him. There's still something about him that we like. And much of that, I think, has to do with Welles' own innate charisma, but it also is the film's strategy to keep us kind of off balance about what we can make of this guy. We're from scene to scene, depending on who's telling the story, depending on the point of his life, we may be more or less sympathetic to him.
Yes, and each of the people that the reporter meets, in their own way, they wanted something out of Kane. They wanted a way of him to behave, or he inspired them. The guardian wanted some discipline on him, and his presentation can't be just more stark and authoritarian. The newspaper man is inspired by his principles, and so his stuff is a lot more energetic and vibrant as a result. And then you have the friendship between Kane and Leland. Leland has such an awareness of both the virtues and flaws that he finds in Kane.
Right, because Everett Sloan's character, Bernstein, is much less questioning. He's somebody who has pure admiration for Kane. But Leland sees a bit deeper, sees some of the dark side.
This reminds me of a film called Rashomon that came out in the 50s, which was about four different people relating situation in four different ways. And the director, Akira Kurosawa, made a really great choice of depicting each one of these four people's recollections in a different style of filmmaking. But that happened decades earlier, off in Citizen Kane. Using that newsreel is great because it shows this way of very familiar way of looking over the life of a great person and seeing what this person's like in just a way that people are very familiar with. Just the details, the grand moments of history that he was involved in, and the general boilerplate depictions of a titan of industry and so forth. But then when the reporter takes a further look into the person who was his guardian, and then his business partner, then his closest confidant, and his ex-wife, each one is depicted in a unique manner. The guardian, for example, is as stark as you could get from any kind of expressionistic film where it's just a vast open chamber with a shaft of diagonal light looking right down at a book. Business partner is a lot closer together and there's a lot more books and other papers around him, and it's a lot more casual. The talk with his closest friend has this really wry, melancholy aspect to it as he's just relating to this past of his relationship with the Charles Foster Kane and with the ex-wife, as you literally show it through a skylight that's It's a shot that moves through a skylight down into a building in the middle of a rainstorm.
First, though, through a neon sign.
Yes.
Talk about audacious. This is the kind of thing we did not see in 1941. This is the kind of thing that was hinted at in the silent era with German expressionism and people like Fritz Lang and F.W. Murnau. But film kind of had to restart with the sound era. And Citizen Kane was the announcement that now film has arrived in sound at the apex it was heading towards in silence.
There's one particular shot that I would want to just underline that just kind of gives you a whole sense of where, like, Welles' ability and talent. It's a very small scene, but there's a scene about halfway through where Kane is signing off financial dealings to a trust company. And so his fortune is being sort of taken away from him. And as his lawyers are discussing over the matter in the foreground, Kane himself slowly ambles back into the background. If you actually look at the really closely, the windows appear to be 20 feet high. That's because they were 20 feet high.
Right.
But obviously they're not working as windows. He is literally diminishing himself into being smaller because of his reduced stature as a person. And now think about that. Think about the person who decides to build windows that are way higher than they have any right to be and saying, no, if you look at them in the camera, it's going to work. It's not going to look like a terrible, horrible forced perspective. But people are going to believe it. And it works.
And in another scene later on in the film, in Xanadu, when you see these fireplaces, this fireplace from a distance, and as you approach the fireplace, it becomes clear that it is not a normal size fireplace, that it is a fireplace that could be, that is probably 10 feet tall. But the thing is, these visual innovations don't work in isolation. They each one furthers the story and gets us deeper into these characters. So when you have, for instance, cameras placed incredibly low, holes cut in the floor so the cameras can be placed so low,
right?
it creates these angles that are not just there for effect, but are there to show the massive ego of Kane's character and are adjusted to show various points at which he's either on a high or on a low until you get another shot where he's walking past a series of mirrors that reflect him endlessly one after another.
Right, right. That's near the conclusion after one hell of a room trashing.
Right. And the thing about this is that we don't just get a few of these. It's an embarrassment of riches. Every single shot, every single edit is like this. So you have a scene with Kane and his wife at a dinner table. In the beginning of their marriage, they're sitting close together and talking to each other and engaging. As time goes on, instead of showing the marriage falling apart through words, it's shown visually as you see the table get longer with each cut and the two actors being more distant from each other until finally Kane just snaps at his wife and they're at this really long table.
See how magical that is? You're literally showing the entire disintegration of a relationship through furniture.
Right.
And he does such a similar magic with the parts where Kane's character tries to become a political figure with his face on this just enormous 50-foot-high tapestry. And the audience is like just these shadowy, like parallel lines off in the borders, you know. It gives off just such a great sense of this being a megaphone for Kane to express himself.
Mm-hmm.
And that's one of the things that the movie explores in a similar way of how Rashomon looks at a situation. This is a movie which is, I think, one of the first that I've seen which attempted to go and make the point of the central enigma of what drives people to even do great things and magnificent things. You kind of think that they're done as a result of principles and lofty goals. But in fact, part of the thing that the movie does is take the Mickey out of that exact mm-hmm. concept, right?
Right?
By having him draw up these principles and the way that they are used and misused in the film kind of puts a mockery to that.
What's wonderful about that is not that he's being disingenuous when he draws them up. He truly believes in the principles at the time. But as he becomes more and more successful, as he dominates the newspaper business, he realizes that they seem no longer to apply to him. That these are rules for other people, not for Charles Foster Kane. So there's an amazing scene where he's in conflict with Joseph Cotton's character, who is the one who has to point out to him that he is being a hypocrite, that he is not living under these principles that he set forth. He's become the drama critic of the paper, and Kane's second wife, who Kane wanted to establish as this great opera star, is in fact not a great singer at all. But because Kane owns the paper, he would expect nothing but rave reviews from her disastrous performance. Jebediah writes a poor review, realizes that this will, in essence, destroy their friendship, gets drunk, and Kane comes in and finishes the review as a poor review. And even the way the typewriter is used as a prop is just right. A moment of genius when he presses that button to have the typewriter make that, I don't even know what the typewriter noise is called again.
The carriage return noise, swings back?
Exactly. As an explanation point to basically, again, through showing, not telling, portray the end of this friendship.
Right. It just ends with a mechanical noise, so mm-hmm. like with with the most authority of a mechanical noise since maybe the dum dum noise from Law and Order.
There you go.
And that motion, the carriage return that dissolves Leland and Kane's relationship, is born of a perspective on Kane that's brought in just right after when you look at Kane's ex-wife. And Kane's attempt to make her into an opera star, despite even her wishes or her even belief in her own abilities to do that. At that point, you get to a little more of the core of Kane in that he wants to go and impose his own reality on things. He's so open in the beginning of the sense of possibility and the way about how all these restrictions that other people, maybe mere mortals for him, are concerned with and how he's willing to dismiss them. He has a really nice line where he says to his guardian, "Oh, sure, I've lost $1 million on this newspaper. I'll probably lose $1 million more a year after and the year after that."
Right. This attitude is also reinforced during his political campaign when he's brought down by his opponents and he yells something, "You can't do this to me. I'm Charles Foster Kane." And that is the attitude that he brings forward in different points of his life and keeps saying in different ways. So when you get to Susan's relationship, his political career is over and he's replaced it by trying to be this Svengali mentor character, as that creates such havoc on their relationship. He doesn't treat her as a person. He treats her as a goal, as a means to an end. Mm-hmm. And as that leads to the dissolution of this second marriage, he still doesn't understand that the world doesn't revolve around him, that other people have agency.
And that's what makes that mirror scene at the end so wonderfully poignant. Does Kane even view people as other people or mere reflections of things that he wants for himself? Like, that desire to make his wife a opera star is brought to just such stark depictions through the same whirling that was used to show the dissolution of his first marriage, to show the end of his first marriage with the table, is done vertically as it swirls to show Susan in ever more elaborate attempts to have a performance. And then when she finally has her disastrous performance, it slowly pans up to show the negative review from the people working in the rafters. And Kane follows it up by literally trying to will the audience to applause by doing the angriest slow clap depicted in motion picture history.
And in memes for the last however many years. But that scene where the camera pans up through the rafters is a great example of how the technical innovation of Kane meets the narrative power of this film, because that's another kind of shot that we would not have seen until then, that was invented for this kind of film, yet it's invisible to us because it makes so much story sense.
Exactly right. The intent just follows through by what we are looking at and what we're trying to wonder and what Kane is doing and what we think he might do next. One thing that really can't be said actually enough about this film and hasn't been said enough is that the Kane is a special effects powerhouse. There was so many things that were invented in terms of depicting things on film that came from this movie. It's now put to use to go and express Susan's plight, which is, what on earth brought Kane to think to do that to Susan, at Susan maybe? What is the motivation for him to try to make her a big star?
Well, it might be the same thing that motivates him throughout this film, which is this almost pathological need to be loved without any concern about loving other people in return. And this is brought out through some dialogue, but it's very well developed throughout. It's an endless need that can really never be fulfilled. For all the talk about Rosebud being the meaning of his life, it might be this void that Welles is presenting Kane as that's even more resonant in my reading.
But like you said, he could never fill it.
Exactly. It's the tragedy of the character, and it's what causes him to treat others so callously, to constantly be elevating himself, to so easily switch from one type of endeavor to the next with the only thing they all have in common, this desire to be loved.
You look also at the ways that, like, he self-destructs. Obviously, the destruction of Susan's room right after she points out that she's leaving him, but also in how he decides to continue on with his campaign, despite the giving the opportunity to resign. He just won't be denied to do the thing he wants to do.
Right, and in those days, evidence of an affair would have been the very end. There'd be no question what would happen next. But Kane does not give an inch.
Yeah. And the film is so good at showing this just on the use of space.
Mm-hmm.
Not just the furniture, but the cavernous environments. And in the final moments of just the vast array of wreckage, junk, garbage. What kind of a cynicism comes from saying, look at all this amassed work and what did it really amount to?
Well, this is another reading of the film, which is that it could be looked at as anti-materialistic. You know, we see this man collecting constantly, but not really enjoying anything he collects. He just wants to amass more and more things until you do have that amazing final shot of this endless array of boxes that Spielberg would appropriate for his final shot of Raiders of the Lost Ark.
Right, right. It leads me to think about one of my favorite lines from The Big Lebowski, and to look at Citizen Kane and the prospect of how the dude talks about Jackie Treehorn, saying, man, he treats these people like they're objects and objects like they're people. The movie starts with a place, but also starts with an object. It's a snow globe of something that looks to be his home when he was a child. But unlike those boxes, which are random and rectangular and just piles of rubble, the snow globe is like a perfect circle.
Right. And a perfect reminder of a time when he could have been a different person of his childhood. And if there's anybody out there who does not know what Rosebud is, fast forward at this point. But I think most of you know that Rosebud is, in fact, Kane's childhood sled, which I guess is meant to bring back memories of a more innocent time. But I think it's also perhaps less important to the film, to the film's themes, than it's often given credit for. It's a good structural tying up point, this Rosebud mystery. But there's also a really good argument to be made that it doesn't really explain Kane. That kind of idea of a lost childhood could apply to anybody. But what we've seen of Kane in the various stories told by the people in his life are what we're going to get to know about this enigma more than just this idea of the sled. But despite that, it's such a powerful story structure tool that it helps. You mentioned The Big Lebowski. It helps tie the film together.
Nicely put.
Yeah.
I am at a loss right now if to really see a movie that was made up until that point, and very few since, that when you really think about Rosebud, if you really seriously think about it, apart from the sort of historical things behind the name, which we'll get to in a little bit, but think about that in this movie is about a guy, and you see this very robust person, someone who's like moved mountains politically and socially, someone who's like had this gigantic rise and this gigantic fall, and at the end, to point out what's left is a phrase that people don't understand about an object that no one at that point alive would recognize is what it is.
And a phrase that is not actually heard by anyone. Because when he says Rosebud, we see it as an audience, but we also see that he is alone in the room. So it is certainly a purposeful decision and not an error, but it's a very interesting one to state that not only can you not sum a man's life up with one word, but nobody even heard him say the word.
Yeah, that's a little bit of a mystery too far for me. I kind of want to say that at the end, when the caretaker at the end said, well, when he said Rosebud was his last word, that he was just sitting in the corner and we didn't get the chance to see it. And it's just a way of the movie letting us feel what you describe, that in the end, he says this word that had some meaning, but no one was here to hear it except us in the audience. But I want to bring up that there's just a final twist in the knife. When it, by calling, why is it Rosebud? Why do you say the name of a sled, Rosebud? Why would you give the name of a flower to something that's used when there is no flowers growing? That is an extra level of even the name of that object doesn't fit. And this is such an interesting perspective because it's an ambiguity layer cake. It's something that shows all the scope of a human's life, of a person's life, all the different perspectives you can give to it while making it a mystery within a mystery within a mystery that's not known to anybody, including the person themselves.
Exactly. And it's probably a little silly for there to be an official greatest film ever made. But if there is one, wouldn't one that encapsulates all that be an appropriate choice?
This is one case where calling like a film a masterpiece or calling an artist a genius, it just can somehow work against it. Because as you said earlier, you treat it like it's a museum piece. And you think that this is a film to just be revered or analyzed. But this is a film that can be deeply felt. You can have a sense of wonder and enthusiasm and comedy and feel and take the ride and take the experience of this film just as much as you can for giving a film a rigorous analysis about what things might mean.
Right, because some of the most memorable scenes are just very much from the heart. A lot of them surrounding the Bernstein character. He has this wonderful speech where he talks about just seeing a woman and never seeing her again, but never forgetting that moment in his life. Or another line that strikes me as just very appropriate. He says, you know, it's easy to make a lot of money if all you care about is making a lot of money. And the movie is filled with moments like that. Moments that are funny, moments that are wise, moments that are meaningful, and every one of those moments is attached to something beautiful happening on screen.
Yes, and the scope of what was happening on screen had such a resonance. In a way, it's kind of the ultimate takedown of people rich, famous, powerful, to say maybe they're just as clueless as anybody else. Maybe the thing that drives them is something that's kind of unknown to itself. And it turns out that in his first film is not only triumphant on the scope of it, but also gave the hints, the rosebud seed to Welles' own folly.
Right, because unfortunately, the takedown was not merely aimed at people like Kane in general, but a very specific person that seemed to be a little too like Kane, which is the gigantic publisher at the time, William Randolph Hearst, who controlled the newspapers and the media. Kane and Mankiewicz certainly would have had him in mind in a number of aspects of the character, although it's really an oversimplification to say it's just Hearst. It's not. It could just as well be Welles as Hearst. But there were enough similarities, particularly in the treatment of the Susan Alexander character, who is clearly meant to evoke Hearst's mistress, the actress Marion Davies. And in, again, urban legend world, there is a rumor out there that Hearst had a nickname for his mistress's most private of private parts, which was Rosebud.
Now, that is an interesting case of particular self-destruction on Welles' part, because if that is even close to true, you literally went and attacked a guy's mistress. Yes. With the most, one of the most personal insults imaginable, someone who has been able to make and break in whole careers instantaneously. And in fact, they even tried and nearly succeeded in keeping Kane from being airing.
Right. Hearst basically went to all the studio heads and told them that he wanted every copy, every print of this film destroyed. and he almost succeeded. So many of them were. Fortunately, there were some enterprising folks who were able to bring Kane beyond his reach, and it did get released, but it got released amid this controversy, amid the attacks from Hearst. It was not the kind of gigantic moneymaker that was expected from the boy genius Orson Welles, and some theaters wouldn't play it. So the complete control that Welles was given on his first film would never be allotted to him again.
Welles just took things just a little too far, and in a way that I almost think is a little deliberate. Kane is not some irredeemable bastard. It doesn't appear that Welles had an axe to grind against Hearst or newspaper men in general. It's a deliberate provocation for no particular good reason, you know? Kane not only showed off just the audacity of Welles's just creativity, the audacity of his scope, but also in the audacity of his provocation. This may be the most costliest veiled insult in filmmaking history, and one that led to dire repercussions for Orson Welles' next film, The Magnificent Ambersons, in 1942.